Anyway, thank you all so much. We can actually get started for real now. My name is Brett White. I'm a senior reporter producer for Decider. And I am writing a biography of Hayden Rorke, who is over my shoulder. I bought that early in my journey because I figured I should have something of his in my office while I do this. So I've been working on this book for 16 months. I have interviewed a lot of people, including people that are in here, which is I'm very honored, honestly. So I'm going to start by actually playing a clip.
Not all our preparations in... Now, my little cheeky, not all our preparations in order. You have the knife?
Yes.
The silver wire?
Yes.
The map?
Yes.
The explosives?
Yes.
The two-way wrist television set?
Yes.
Good.
I cannot think as a patriot. My blood is pounding in my ears. As a woman, I beg of you, be weak again.
The roar of my blood is loud indeed. What a tragedy my life has been up to now. I see for the first time that love is to live. Hey. Not bad, eh?
So yeah, that is obviously, maybe I should have said beforehand, that is from Hayden's appearance on the I Love Lucy episode, New Neighbors, which if you didn't know, Hayden and Jess are kind of responsible for Lucille Ball being a thing. By the time they, in about like the late 40s, she was kind of a washed up movie actor because none of her movies ever really hit. And it wasn't until she starred in Dream Girl, which Hayden was in and just directed, that critics actually were like, wait a second, this is Lucille Ball. When you put her in front of an audience, she's funny. And that like momentum took her all the way to doing I Love Lucy. And then when she got that job, she, as thanks, got Hayden on the show, which I do believe that is his first ever TV appearance. So like, fun. And that kind of leads into the first reading that I'm gonna do, which is about Hayden and Jess, their summer stock and their early 1940s theatrical experiences they would do, which when I was writing this section, I discovered something really wild that took me down a ridiculous rabbit hole, which is kind of, every time I find one of those, it just proves why this story is worth telling, because Hayden and Jess lived such fascinating lives and ran across so many fascinating people. So I am going to start by reading this passage, and I guess you're just going to listen to me, and I'm going to try and be very entertaining and emphatic with my hands. So this is spring 1940. So take yourself back to spring 1940 and let me take a drink from my Golden Girls cup. Okay, so picture it, Golden Girls, spring 1940. Hayden Rourke's sole public-facing romance was with the burlesque icon Ann Corio. While a trailblazer in her field, Corio's body of work was frequently boiled down to just being a stripper. Hayden, however, didn't view Corio as a tawdry taboo. Hayden saw a captivating stage performer, one deserving of respect and applause from everyone. I'm trying to also let people into the room while we're all reading, so that's going to be fun. Anyway, Hayden, however, didn't view Corio as a tawdry taboo. Hayden saw a captivating stage performer, one deserving of respect and applause from everybody. Of course, gossip columnists of the era saw this professional affair between an unmarried 30-year-old man and a burlesque dancer as undoubtedly intimate. completely missing, or perhaps intentionally camouflaging, the fact that Hayden's real intimate relationship was with a man who was standing literally right there. In fact, Hayden's lifelong platonic relationship with Ann Corio began as a result of him and Justice Addis making a major commitment to each other in 1940. After spending the previous two summers working summer stock together in Rhode Island, the two of them decided to make it official by starting their own summer stock at the Chapel Playhouse in Guilford, Connecticut. The couple filed papers in late May 1940, incorporating the Chapel Playhouse players with Justice J. Addis III of New York City as president and Hayden Rorke, also of New York City, as vice president. Now in the producing business, Hayden and Just lined up a season of plays and paired them with leads. The season kicked off on July 1st, 1940, with a sold-out performance of The Late Christopher Bean. Hayden, however, was surely focused on White Cargo, which was the next play in rotation. Hayden would make his Chapel Playhouse debut alongside Lily DeMita as the co-lead of White Cargo. A star of France's silent film era, DeMita starred in a string of pre-code American films that made her a star in the States. That is one reason why Errol Flynn cozied up to DeMita during his literal cruise to stardom. Flynn met DeMita on the ship from London to the United States, where he was set to make his Hollywood debut. DeMita was 5 years Flynn's senior and had a decade's worth of connections that Flynn could use. And as his star rose, DeMita's fell. She retired from acting shortly after their marriage in 1935. And then Rorke and Addis came calling. The whole affair started innocently enough with a syndicated news item reading, "Lily DeMita's in line for stage work under an assumed name." While Errol Flynn was down in Puerto Rico doing research for a Simon Bolivar movie that would ultimately go nowhere, DeMita was starring in a production of White Cargo up in Guilford. White Cargo with Lily DeMita and Hayden Rourke opened in the Chapel Playhouse on July 8, 1940, playing to an at-capacity crowd. As one review put it, DeMita played her part to perfection, and leading man Hayden Rourke kept the audience plot conscious as his experience on the stage was brought out in the part of Alan Langford. There's a compliment in there somewhere, but honestly, it is just remarkable that Hayden got mentioned at all when he was on stage with Errol Flynn's half-naked wife. Hayden probably didn't know it at the time, but he had kind of become the other man. Errol Flynn not only had no idea that his wife was being manhandled on stage by a thespian, he had no idea where his wife was, period. Right after White Cargo's debut in Guilford, legendary gossip columnist Luella Parsons turned her national column into a text message convo between a confused husband and a wife who had big New Telegraph who dis energy. On July 8th, 1940, Parsons relayed this rather personal message from Flynn to the entire country. Errol Flynn pining for Lily DeMita. Agony column. Will Lily DeMita please contact Errol Flynn, who is pining for her and who would like to know where she is hiding? A liberal reward, says Errol, will be paid to anyone giving information. Sorry, Errol. Lily saw an opening and she took it. A few days later, a column by May Mann added some belated context to Flynn's agony. Telephoned Errol Flynn's house to find that he's really ill and very much so with malaria fever from South America. He hasn't seen his wife, Lily DeMita, and is having all his friends paged to learn her whereabouts. The drama continued in Parsons' July 10th column. Speaking of Errol Flynn, he has had his option taken up at Warner's, and when I talked it with him Wednesday, he said, please, that no reward is now offered for Lily's return. So my advice to her is to stop her nonsense and come home. On July 11th, halfway through White Cargo's run at the Chapel, the runaway bride replied to her husband via, what else, Luella Parsons' column, and the whole thing is fantastic. Attention, Errol Flynn. Here's a letter from Lily dated July 7th, Guilford, Connecticut. Says the DeMita, don't let the above address fool you. Am residing in a tourist camp somewhere in Connecticut. Tomorrow is the big opening of White Cargo, in which I am the vamp who kicks the bucket, treacherously poisoned by one of my ex-flames. That's Hayden Rourke. I've been doing practically all the summer theaters, watching my colleagues perform and actually living the same life the apprentices do. Just finished No More Ladies at Deer Lake under an assumed name. Don't forget, I gave up all my stage and screen activities when I married Flynn 6 years ago. To make a long story short, Flynn just wired that he will be back around July 10th, and that means little lassie come home. Much to my sorrow, I've promised Martin Jones to go to Southampton and rehearse a new play, but you know Lily, she'll probably be at the airport with a warm welcome for the prodigal son. Microphone drop. And that is the first reading. So I don't know. I mean, if I think everyone can unmute their microphones if you have any questions about that passage. I hope you enjoyed it. That is, this is my first attempt at ever writing a biography or a book. So, but when I discovered that Hayden was essentially on stage with Errol Flynn's wife while she was on the run from her husband, it just puts all that stuff in such an interesting, fascinating context. And then when you like read Errol Flynn biographies and stuff, they aren't going to mention the fact that, yeah, the other person on stage is Dr. Bellows from I Dream of Jeannie. But this actually kind of leads us to the next passage and clip that I'm going to play, and I'm going to do it a lot smoother this time. Don't worry. The tour with White Cargo actually got cut short because of World War II, which brings us to This Is the Army. So I'm going to play this clip, which is all of Hayden's scenes in 1943's This Is the Army feature film starring Ronald Reagan. So let me share screen.
Get changed for the Air Corps number now. Anderson, is everything all set for the stage door canteen number, props and everything?
Yeah, I think so. This just came for you. All right, get on stage, you prima donnas. Let's go. Get on for stage door canteen.
Hey, fellas, get a load of this wire.
Anybody I know, Jan?
We're going on tour. What do you know, Boston, Philadelphia, Washington?
Washington? Hey, wouldn't it be something if the president came to see us, the chief himself?
Yeah, wouldn't it be something if we could get this makeup off our kisses before the war's over?
You said it.
Fellas, the president. Gee, I'd like to go out and thank him for that raise he gave us.
Canteen number.
And that is it. What is actually really weird is that in both of Hayden's scenes, he's introducing the canteen number, which is the big stage door canteen number at the top of Act Two, which involves just a ton of drag performances and impressions and singing and dancing. And in that, he plays Noel Coward. Like, that's his one big thing in This Is the Army. He's on stage doing Noel Coward. But in the movie, he doesn't do that. They have one person do a bunch of impressions, but they still made Hayden introduce that number twice, which just seems kind of shady. I don't know. But yeah, that is Hayden Rorke in a scene with Ronald Reagan, which is fully wild. But now I'm going to move on and read about World War II. I've been working on the World War II portion of the book for the past month, which, considering that I am not an army person or really a Broadway person, is hard. So a lot of research is going into this part, but I've read a lot of books about Irving Berlin and everyone that was involved in This Is the Army. So I'm trying to really put together the comprehensive, Hayden and Just's comprehensive story of This Is the Army, because that's a story that's never been told. A lot of the This Is the Army stuff has been told from the straight soldiers, and there were a bunch of gay soldiers in This Is the Army, including Cole Porter's boyfriend, Nelson Barclift. Also, Josh Logan, who wrote South Pacific, came in for a hot second to direct. And Robert Sidney, who was a choreographer for Dean Martin in the 60s. And yeah, so here is my take on how World War II started. Let's do it. In order to keep homosexuals out of the army, the United States Armed Forces placed 550 psychiatrists on the front lines of recruitment. By the time Hayden and Just were drafted in early 1942, these screening procedures were set in stone. Now, Hayden, Just, and hundreds of thousands, perhaps over a million, queer soldiers had to get through examination without being outed and suffering the consequences. Just enlisted first, which clipped White Cargo's tour short just before Chicago. He arrived at Camp Upton in Yaphank, New York on February 14th, where he underwent physical and mental examinations, partly designed to suss out homosexuals. Hayden's call to duty came just over a month later on April 1st, 1942. Unlike Just, Hayden reported to Fort Jay on Governor's Island, a base that just 4 months earlier received a two-page spread in the New York Daily News detailing Fort Jay's mission to weed out men liable to crack up in battle. Hayden had a lot to think about on that crisp springtime ferry ride from Wall Street to Governor's Island, major decisions he'd most likely been mulling over since his partner was summoned to Camp Upton just 6 weeks prior. Hayden and Just enlisted after a regulation was put in place that gave examiners an itemized list of telltale signs that a man might be homosexual, like feminine bodily characteristics and effeminacy in dress and manner. Clearly, Just had made it through whatever screening was in place out on Long Island, but screenings differed at every camp. According to the Daily News piece, Fort Jay was where gay men went not to come out, but to get caught. A passage reads, "Over at Fort Jay, Governor's Island, where from 500 to 800 registrants are examined daily by the core area examination team, sometimes as many as 8 homosexuals per day are found. They have to be weeded out from groups that have already been purged." I don't really know what the purged part of that means. Hayden was not the type to shirk any responsibility, though. Even when he skipped classes in high school, it was so he could audition for Broadway plays, which were jobs. Hayden passed his physical and mental exams, assuredly batting away whatever invasive questions were lobbed at him with his usual bombast and grace. Hayden Rorke was in the Army now. However, there is another version of Hayden and Jess's enlistment story, one that's riskier, more romantic, and maybe apocryphal. In his memoir, The Songwriter Goes to War, stage manager Alan Anderson introduces Hayden and Just into his narrative thusly. Just Addison and Hayden Rourke had worked together in the theater for several years before the war. They'd started producing their own shows out of town. Just had done some directing and a great deal of stage managing. Hayden was a very good character actor. When Just received his draft notice, Hayden had volunteered immediately so that they reported for duty at Camp Upton at the same time. Like, can we just revel in that romance for a minute? I mean, Morgul the Girls, picture it. A hotel in Detroit, early February 1942. Just and Hayden wake up, ready to heat up a winter day with another performance of White Cargo at the Lafayette. Hayden, somehow wide awake within minutes of the alarm sounding, prepares for his morning ritual, a swimming lapse, while Just does the responsible thing and phones the front desk for any messages. He has one. "Please call the office of Addison Rourke." The sound of the phone's rotary dial clicking through each number mingles with the sound of Hayden in the bathroom, buckling his dashing swimsuit. Just greets his secretary as Hayden drapes a folded towel around his neck like an opera cape and slides his feet to a pair of leather slippers. It's the same morning routine they've enjoyed for the last week. And then there's a silence that Hayden hasn't heard before, a silence that stops his hand short of turning the doorknob. Just hangs up the phone. His eyes drift to his partner. Hayden, perpetually in sync with the man he shared his life with for the last 7 years, knows the inevitable letter was delivered to their Manhattan office. Hayden, hands now confidently on his hips and cutting a Superman-like figure, doesn't even blink. "So," he says with bravado, "where do we report to?" I mean, come on, don't you want that to be true? I mean, Alan Anderson's version of events is the dream version, isn't it? It's not supported by the Army's own records, which list Just as enlisting on Valentine's Day, 1942, which is romantic, and Hayden on April Fool's Day, 1942, less romantic. On the other hand, Anderson interviewed Hayden in 1986 and stayed in touch with him up until the very end. Hayden even handed over all of his and Just's World War II artifacts to Anderson. So it's highly likely that this story, the story of Hayden heading off to war ahead of his draft date in the hopes that he wouldn't be separated from the man he loved, came from Hayden himself. But on the other hand, Hayden's friend Steve Olam recalls a different, still romantic version of Hayden and Just's reunion at Camp Upton. And this one makes sense with their differing enlistment dates. "As I understand it, Just was drafted," began Olam, who most likely heard this story in late 1979 while he was caring for Hayden after Just's passing. "Of course, by then, they already had this affection going on between them. As I remember Hayden telling me, he didn't really probably plan on seeing Just in the Army. And then Hayden was drafted. And he said, 'I went through the initial phases of enlisting and was assigned to a barracks. I walked in the barracks and there was Just. I was so happy to see him, and he was so surprised to see me.'" So Hayden and Just either enlisted together, looking Uncle Sam in the face and daring him to split them up, or fate dealt them a surprise one in a million reunion in the barracks. Either way, romantic. And that is how, but yeah, so the next, I'm trying to think, then the next segment is gonna be the big one. It's the I Dream of Jeannie, which I think is what everyone, of course, is most interested in. When I started writing the book proper after doing a year of research, I started with the Jeannie section because that's what you want. You wanna know about I Dream of Jeannie. And I've been lucky enough to be able to talk to Barbara Eden, Larry Hagman's daughter, Bill Daly's son, Emmeline Henry's sister. Emmeline Henry played Amanda Bellows, Hayden's TV wife. And her sister is 93. Like, and it's her older sister too. Like, and so I got to talk to her and she was totally delightful and actually told me stuff about Emmeline Henry that the internet does not know, like that she was actually married. The next segment is I Dream of Jeannie stuff. And it's, I don't know, it's like part of my my favorite stuff. And this will be the last passage and then, you know, do whatever. So you won't have to hear me read anymore. So let's do this. Let me take another drink. So I Dream of Jeannie, we are now in, this is about like summer, this is like 65, 66. This is part of the first Jeannie chunk. There's gonna be a lot of Jeannie in this book. So dinners were the social event of the era, not board game nights, not movie marathons, not karaoke outings, dinners, and not potluck meals or pizza parties either. These were dinners with an implied capital D, affairs that required formal dress. And in the case of Hayden and Juss's, catered meals and sometimes a hired wait staff. When the cast started to socialize a bit more outside of work, Hayden and Juss's Studio City home became the spot for casual get-togethers for the cast. Casual for the era, formal compared to today's t-shirt and jeans world. His dinner parties were more small affairs, recalls Eden. Maybe 8 people, 10 people, but all people who knew each other and could sit down and talk and have conversations. Just like he would sometimes swing by the Jeannie set, of course, Justice was at these dinners playing the role of the grounded husband to Hayden's energetic host. Eden recalls their complementary dynamic. Justice was a little more, how can I put it, serious, I guess. But that's not true, because Hayden was a very serious man too, but Hayden was more gregarious. He could chat with people and talk and make everyone comfortable. And Justice was more cerebral within himself. And he was a lovely man. I loved him as a director. Side note, Barbara just directed Barbara in a thing before Jeannie even. So Barbara met Just before she met Hayden. Hayden was certainly the performer of the two, says Patrick Bailey, who attended many, many of these dinner parties as a preteen. Hayden was the actor, and the actors always need attention. So he was the most, you know, overt of the two. I just remember them being a great couple. Patrick's mother, Bill Daly's first wife, Patricia Anderson, was always delighted to attend one of Hayden's parties, especially since it sometimes meant dining with stars like Cesar Romero. Hayden was just adorable, both he and Juss, says Anderson. Hayden as dinner party host, a welcoming mix of flamboyant patriarch and consummate storyteller, was perhaps his most recognizable role amongst his friends and partners. He was such a party guest even at his own party, says Mike Wills, with eternal affection for his former companion. He had stories he told, hilarious and funny, but he never delved into the serious things. I assume that Juss was more that person. To further set the scene for one of Hayden and Juss's soirees, the driveway leading up to their modest mid-century suburban home would be lined with paper lanterns flickering in the night to light the way to the front door. The task of lighting those lanterns would fall to the younger generation, the nephews Ricky and Kevin, or Kevin's wife Patty, should they be in attendance. While modest compared to the more Hollywood abodes occupied by Barbara Eden and Larry Hagman, the Rorke and Addis home was exquisitely decorated with plenty of keepsakes and artifacts from the couple's world travels and their careers. Hayden himself would often answer the door in his go-to casual look of a dark maroon smoking jacket, ascot, and velvet slippers, no doubt topped off with his trusty pipe. Somehow Christina Hagman thinks Hayden seemed even more English while at home, never mind the fact that he's a Brooklyn boy. While Hayden made conversation, a waiter would circulate, handing out drinks and hors d'oeuvres while the dinner was prepared. Dinner would consist of unique dishes from around the world, like prosciutto consomme with arugula and a cantaloupe. These dinner parties sound like the epitome of adults-only gatherings, like the kind of get-togethers that would leave kids bored and glaring at a hollowed-out melon with beef juice in it. But that was far from the case with Hayden and Jess's house. And with Hayden and Jess, he was very kind and patient because I was a little girl, right? Says Christina Hagman. He didn't talk down to me. He was just such a gentleman, so kind. But of all the Genie kids, though, Hayden's bond with Bill Daly's children, Patrick and Kimberly, was unquestionably the strongest. The bond was so strong that it literally made the news. This bit of TV fluff was published in February 1968, and it reads, Hayden Rorke, who plays the psychiatrist on Dr. Bellows on NBC TV's I Dream of Jeannie, has been named an honorary uncle by fellow performer Bill Daly's children. The children have even given Hayden their prized ceramic objects they made in a school kiln, objects which might not bring a big prize in an art gallery, but which the Bachelor Rorke prizes above Rodin originals. So this is all true. The heart of it is true, as far as Patrick Daly is concerned. I'm sure Dad just, you know, Dad loved to talk and Dad just said things. I don't know. There was nothing official about it. It was just, he was my Uncle Hayden. It should also be noted that calling the 58-year-old actor a bachelor was as close as a newspaper could come to saying, this man is wonderfully homosexual. I Dream of Jeannie may have only been in production for 5 years, but the 5 years that Patrick spent seeing his Uncle Hayden made a profound, lasting impact on his life. I grew up in a very liberal household, and my parents never made an issue out of Hayden and just being a gay couple, but we knew what it was. We understood it, says Daly, which makes way more sense than Bill Daly's comments in the Dreaming of Jeannie book that he had no idea Hayden was gay. It's much more likely that Bill was fudging the truth a bit to protect Hayden's reputation, as attitudes towards gay actors in the late 1990s were not as accepting as Bill Daly apparently was in the late 1960s. Patrick continues. In 1968, I was like 10 or 11. I was born in 1957. So all my experiences with Hayden were all pre-teenager. They were all when I was 8 to 12 years old. So, you know, the facts of life were never discussed with a kid that young anyway, but it was never hidden either. In fact, Bill Daly would frequently say that of all the couples he knew in Hollywood, Hayden and Jess were the ones that he would trust his kids with the most without any hesitation. He was the most comfortable with his children spending time with them, and that was definitely not normal for people. That was not a normal reputation for gay couples to have in the late 1960s. The Daly family would visit Uncle Hayden and Uncle Jess often, beyond those fancy cast dinners. I think we probably went over to their house seasonally, says Patrick. You know, so for the last 5 years of Jeannie, I was over at his house every couple of months for a dinner, a party, or something. Those visits to Uncle Hayden's would always ignite Patrick's curiosity, as the seasoned actor had no shortage of priceless heirlooms and trinkets to mess with. Hayden always let Patrick take objects off of his many shelves for inspection, perhaps because Hayden knew that an object in Patrick's hand was an opportunity for him to regale the kid with a story. I love the stuff on his shelves, and he was so open about just letting us, oh, you have to see this. It wasn't like, oh, don't touch that. You know, an 8-year-old grabbing a piece of art off his shelf, he was cool about it. Among items Patrick remembers inspecting are an antique puzzle box. I remember sitting on the couch with it on my lap and just working it, trying to figure it out. And a ball within a ball, one of the ball carved out of ivory from India, possibly acquired during Hayden's tour in Bombay during World War II. You know, Patrick realizes, he shaped a lot of my interest in art. Hayden and Jess shaped a lot more than just Patrick's interest in art. Hayden and Jess were not marching for gay rights. They threw no bricks at Stonewall. They gave no candid interviews to magazines about their gay life together. But just by Hayden and Jess, being Hayden and Jess, just existing in the world as a highly visible couple, and because the straight people around them did not pressure them to censor their truth, they changed minds and therefore lives. It was Patrick Daly. I think the most impactful thing about my Uncle Hayden for me was the accepted attitude towards a gay couple as an 8-year-old. It just formed my opinions at an early age, and I cannot think about gay couples today without thinking about him and Jess. Those years so informed my opinion that no one could dissuade me from that. I remember arguing with a very conservative man once who was talking about gay people, you know, they're like animals. And I just said, I gotta tell you, my Uncle Hayden and his partner Jess were some of the best people I've ever known. And this was way later on as an adult. I was in my mid-20s having this conversation. I'll explain, these were the best people I've known in my life, you know? And so there you go. I mean, what else can you say about that? That says it all. And that's it. That is all of my readings.